Lord, let's close our eyes for prayer again. Father, we thank you for this moment and this hour. We pray that you open the pages of the scripture. Make us to understand, Lord, that your purpose, your will be fulfilled in every life, every church, and the whole nation. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. It's been a wonderful time as we've been sharing together. And when you look at the way you are, I move forward to fulfill your purpose, your plan in my life. I want to talk on a subject that is very important, very close to the heart of God, that he himself spoke about. And I have the text in Deuteronomy chapter 30. Deuteronomy chapter 30, we're looking at verse 19. Here God himself was talking to the children of Israel. And he's talking to the children of Israel. He's talking to the whole nation, every nation here today. And then he's talking to every individual. He's talking about the choices we make in life. As you look at this verse, it says, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. As you think about what God is saying, he's talking about the choices we make in life. You look at your life today, where you are today. Where you are today is a result of the choices you made yesterday. And if you're not satisfied with where you are today, and you feel that this is not the place I ought to be, you better check up on the choices. And because if we keep on doing the same thing we ever did, we're going to be getting the same result we ever got. And if we kept on traveling the same road we ever traveled, we're going to be getting to the same destination that we have always gotten to. And if we're not satisfied with where we are, all we need to do is to check up, what are my choices? We say it this way. We say, decisions determine destiny. That is, all the decisions I took in the years gone by, the result is where I am today. And all the decisions I am today, and all the decisions I will take in life, will land me to a place in eternity. That's today from his word, the choice that counts for eternity. The choice that counts not just for today and not just for this life. The choice that counts for eternity. Here the Lord is saying, make your choice. And understand, you will live with the choices you make for all eternity. Joshua was about to leave the children of Israel as a nation. He knew that when he had gone, the choices they would make will determine what God will do for them. I'm sure you know there are people that think that everything is in the hand of God and they major on God's sovereignty. And they don't think anything about human responsibility. But God is saying, if it were just in my hand, everybody will get to heaven. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. When you think about God's sovereignty, he wants everybody happy, everybody holy, everybody in the family of God. But because of the human responsibility, that's what makes the change. That's why God said, as for me, here is life. As for me, here is blessing. But I'm counseling you, commanding you, helping you to understand that you need to make a choice. And he said, choose life, that you will live, not only you, that all your children, the people after you, will live as well. Here is what Joshua said in Joshua chapter 24, verse 15. He said, and if it be evil in your sight to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. You see, the choice is in our hand. That's why the psalmist looked at his life and he said, I'm happy where I am. I'm happy with what is happening to me. And then he wanted to tell everybody around the reason he was happy. And the reason something good is happening to him, he said in Psalm 119, verse 30, I have choosing the right way. And if you could say that tonight, that's all you need, that you choose the right way. Now, if you look at the topic I announced, I said the choice that counts for eternity. Have you ever thought about eternity? Eternity in human language is time without end. Eternity in human language is the very lifetime of God. And you know, he's been for all eternity and he's going to continue to all eternity. And when we talk about eternity, in fact, you cannot understand. How can I describe that to you? Let's try to illustrate what eternity is. If you think about the biggest, the highest, the broadest, and the deepest mountain here on earth, and you think about a bird that goes to that mountain to sharpen its beak, and then it does that once a year. By the time, you know, once a year. And then it does that once a year. By the time, you know, once a year, it sharpens the beak and then comes to wear that mountain out, you've just passed through a fraction of eternity. Think about that. That's how long eternity is. Think about it another way. And you think about the Mercy River. And then we tell a boy, we say, all we want you to do, you empty this river with this little cup. Once a year, take your cup to Mercy River and draw out the water and then throw it off into the desert. And when you've done that, then go and rest. Following year, come and empty that river with just a cup, a little cup. And when that boy has finished emptying Mercy River, a fraction of eternity has just passed. That's how long eternity is. Are you thinking of eternity? Think about a rope, if that were possible, that goes from the center of the earth, of our globe. And then you attach that rope, if it were possible, to the moon and stretch it out and have an ant walking on that road from earth to the moon and then coming back from the moon to the earth. When the ant has done that, a fraction of eternity has just passed. All I'm saying is, eternity is so long you cannot imagine. And yet, it's the choice we make today that determines what happens to us in all eternity. If I were you, if you were me, you will say, the thing to do then is to find out what kind of choice should I make. Because it is that determines whether you'll be happy, I'll be happy for all eternity. It is that will determine whether anyone will have a fulfilled dream in all eternity. As I talk about the choice that comes for all eternity, I'm going to think about two kinds of people. And then I'm going to make a conclusion. And then I throw it at you to make your own conclusion. I'm going to look at number one, the wise. Number two, I'm going to look at the foolish. And then you make your choice to which side you want to belong to. I can tell immediately you are going to be the wise one. I said you'll be the wise one. You know, sometimes when the church comes together and we'll come together with this kind of breakthrough meeting or revival meeting, or, you know, we sing, we pray, we do everything. And then we come before the Lord and we're considering how I can have pennies instead of having something that will last for eternity. You see, many Christians gather together and they pray. And you think about those prayers, and the prayers are so poor, so puny, and the prayers are so insignificant that God is saying, is that all you can ask? Are you only thinking of today? Just be happy today. Are you only thinking about today? Just be healthy this week or this month. The Lord is thinking about eternity, because time is insignificant in the sight of the Lord. That's the reason he wants you to think like a wise man. Think about eternity. Don't be like the fool that thinks that all there is today is all of life. There is something beyond this. I'm going to think about, number one, the choice of the wise. The choice of the wise. And I have those wise people before me here today. Anybody wise here today? God bless you. You are the one I'm talking about. The choice of the wise. Number two is the choice of a fool. The choice of a fool. And you know, as you read your Bible, there are people that God said This is a fool. And anybody could call any other person a fool. If somebody who is unintelligent or ignorant, doesn't know anything about me and doesn't know my life, my background, or where I am today, and he says, you're a fool, I would measure the man before I put any value on what he's saying. Anybody can say, you're a fool. But when the Almighty God himself, the creator of the heavens and the earth, that knows the past and the present and the future, that knows the man inside out, if he calls this man a fool, that man is a fool. And you want to ask yourself, if the Lord were to think about you today, if the Lord were to think about your life today, will he say, this is a wise man? What makes a wise man? The certificates we have? No. What makes a wise man? The money we have? No. What makes a wise man? The position we hold? No. What makes a wise man? A wise man. You think about Solomon and you think that was the wise man. And you'll be kind of surprised about the conclusion of the Lord himself concerning Solomon. We think he was wise. That man became a fool eventually. When God calls a man a fool, I don't want to be in that position. I don't want you to be in that position. I don't want anybody I love to be in that position. I don't even want my enemy to be in that position. You will not be the foolish man. You will not be the foolish woman. You'll be the wise in the sight of the Lord. Point number one is the choice of the wise. Point number two, the choice of a fool. And then point number three, our choice by faith. Our choice by faith. Number one is the choice of the wise. There's a story in the Bible, and this story is about a woman called Ruth. Actually, Naomi and the husband left the land of Israel, and he went to the land of the Moabites. Well, that mistake, that choice itself, got them some kind of result they were not willing to live with. The man eventually died, and the two sons died. And Naomi, the wife of this man, said, now I hear that God is visiting the people of God again. I'm going back to the land. If we made a foolish choice in the past, that doesn't mean that it's going to be permanent and eternal. We can turn around today, and you are going to turn around. And so Naomi said, well, we made a foolish decision. That's what landed us here. And now this has happened and that has happened. And now I'm going to turn it around. You can always stop, no matter how far you have gone. You can always make a U-turn, no matter what direction you are following. If the direction you are following is not the direction of the wise, you can say, I'm going to be wise. And it doesn't matter what has happened in the past. The Lord will forgive the past. The Lord will forget the past. The Lord will wipe out the past. And a new day will dawn in your life in Jesus' name. It's just as you turn around. And so Naomi said, I'm turning around. And the two daughters-in-law, Ruth and Orpah, they said, we'll go with you. We said, you can't go with me. Why will you go with me? You are young. Because if we're going to take a decision, you're going to make a choice, you have to think through. It's not just something we do at the spur of the moment. And we say, yes, I want to go. Yes, I'm deciding. But if you think through, so if she began to tell them why they needed to think through. You are young. You need to get married. And if I would say that I have hope and I have children today and those children happen to be boys, are you going to wait until they grow up? And when he showed them the cost, then eventually Upper said, thank you very much. I didn't think about that. What didn't I think about that? God, I love you, but I think I love myself more than I love you. Bye. And then she went away. And then Naomi said unto Ruth, he said, your sister-in-law is gone back. Why will you follow me? Your decision must pass through a test. You know, sometimes as we have these evening meetings and, you know, we're saying if you want to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, and this is the greatest decision you could ever take in your life, because it's going to determine where you spend eternity. And then the evangelist most of the time will kind of prop us and encourage us and push us forward and try to help us, and there's soft music playing at the background to help us take the decision. And eventually, emotionally, we'll say, yes, I accept the Lord as my personal Savior, without thinking of the cost of that decision. Because if it's a real decision, it's a total turning around. It means that you're going to disown, you're going to abandon, and you're going to jettison, reject all the other ones that have been lords over your life. And you're saying, Jesus Christ alone, your Savior, Jesus Christ alone, the one that died for you on the cross of Calvary, he will be the Lord. But you know, many times these days, the evangelists don't allow us to think through on the decisions we're taking. That's the reason why many times we take decision on a Saturday, and by Monday we have gone back away from that decision. But our decisions today will be real. That's why Naomi spoke to Ruth and said, your sister-in-law is gone back. How about you? How will you follow me? Can I tell you, we're going to the land of Israel. And I don't know how those people there will receive you. They will receive me because I'm an Israelite. But you, a Moabite, think about that. When we eventually get there, what if they don't accept you? What if they reject you? And what if you don't have a place to live? I cannot guarantee any future for you. Here is where faith comes in. It's a decision of faith. And God always honors faith. And to honor the faith of a Moabitess woman, lady, that was something. Here is the decision that this woman took, and Ruth said, entreat me not. Don't impose that negative thing on me. Entreat me not to leave thee, or to return from following thee after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go. Ruth, what are you saying? Do you know the place this woman is going? No, I don't know, but she has told me about her God. And I see that her God, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, that God that took a whole nation out of captivity and brought them to the promised land, that God is good for me. And the people that are staying with God in sunshine and rain and famine and plenty and difficulty and all the challenges of life, and the Lord has seen them through to this point, that God will be my God. It is an act of faith, a step of faith. It is a decision that goes along with faith. That's why she said, that your people, where you go, I will go. And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. I don't know the condition of the place you are going to lodge, but here is my decision. What a choice, what a choice. The decision you take today as you want to follow the Lord, who can tell you what it will be? It's all by faith. It's like when God called Abraham and said, Abraham, and he said, here am I, Lord. He said, pack all your load, everything you've got. I'm taking you to a place. Where is it, Lord? I know the place. You don't know the place. I'm not going to tell you. You're going to follow me. And Abraham went out not knowing where he was going. That's the faith. That's why. That when God called Abraham and he just believed God, he counted his faith for righteousness. Whatever he had done in his life, that act of faith, following after the Lord said, that is the man of my choice. You choose the Lord, he also chooses you. And then he says, I'll take you to the place I planned for you. And so this Ruth said, your God will be my God, and your people will be my people. Where you die, there I will die. In that same place, I'll be buried. She disowned Moab, her native, natural people, and accepted the people of God, that this will be my people. That is what the Lord is calling us to. When the Lord called all these disciples, follow me, I'll make you this, I'll make you that. All he was saying, forget your past and forget the people. You think that these are my people. He says, this is the choice you make. And they made the choice eventually as they went. You know what happened to Ruth? She became one of the great grandmothers of the Lord Jesus Christ. The decision of that one night, the decision of that one moment determined her destiny. There's no doubt in my mind, there's no doubt in your mind either, if you're a student of the Bible, that Ruth is now in heaven because of the decision of a moment. And that's what I come to tell you tonight, that you can take that decision too, and the Lord himself, he'll honor your faith in Jesus' name. Moab had their own religion, but there was no redemption in that religion. Do you know there are many people today, they'd rather hold on to religion than have the Redeemer. And what the Lord is saying is this: there is no redemptive efficacy, there's no redemptive value in any religion. Religion is just religion. It's a way of searching after God. Is God here? Is God here? Is God there? Job said, I look to the left, I can't find him. I look to the right, I can't find him. And I try to move forward, I can't find him. Is he in the mountain or is he under the sea? I cannot tell. And then he said, who can find out God by searching? And that's what religion tries to do. Philosophers, religionist people, whoever they are, whether Jewish religion or heathenic religion, whatever religion, is just searching for God. But it's not religion, it's redemption. And Jesus came and died on the cross of Calvary. And he said, here is the way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And whosoever follows after me will not walk in darkness. And your decision is, now that I know that religion does not save, however beautiful that religion may be, religion of good works and religion of ceremonies, the religion of sacrifices, whatever religion, it does not save. There is just one Savior. His name is, tell me out loud, his name is Jesus. And whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And it is the wisest decision you could take in your life, that you say, yes, I'm going to call on the name of the Lord. But you know, there are people that, because we're so short-sighted, they think about the pleasures of sin. Do I leave this? And then what am I going to get? It's like when you have a boy or a girl having a toy that costs just £1. And this toy is so beautiful, you know, puts it on the ground, and that thing can run or can talk and do a lot of gimmicks and things. And it's just £1. And you're telling the child, can you give me that toy? And I'm writing a will. And in that will, I'm going to give you something in the will. I'm going to write your name there. You are going to inherit £1,000,000. And a child doesn't understand, what's £1,000,000? I have my toy. You're not going to take my toy away from me. I hold on to my toy. Keep your will and keep your £1,000,000. And that is the way many people, that's what they say, the pleasures of sin and the things we see and the things we hold is just like a toy of £1. And the Lord is saying, I'm writing my will, and I'm going to give you there that inheritance, eternal inheritance. And it's worth more than £1,000,000. Now, you are not a boy, you are not a girl, you are an adult. You are saying, oh Lord, I drop my toy. I want my name to be in your will. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare what? A place for you. Tell me, can you quantify? Can you put some price on that place is going to prepare for you? That's more than £1,000,000. And he's telling you, just drop this toy, £1 toy, or you know, one penny toy. Drop this one. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Think about that. That it's not going to send an angel to come and fetch you and bring you there. He said, I'll come myself. I'll come for you so that where I am, there you will be also. I say, Lord, I can't wait to see that. I want to get there. What is it you want me to drop? This toy, I throw it away. What's pleasure of sin when you compare that with the pleasure and the blessing of the Lord in eternity? You're going to make a wise choice. But it's not everybody in the world that is wise. There are some people that, unfortunately, I'm sorry to say this, there are some people that they hold on to their foolishness. And they hold on, they say, this one, I will not leave this one. And in eternity, they'll wake up to a rude shock because the thing they were holding on to, all of a sudden, everything will lose its value. And then you are faced with eternity. And you said, had I known, I would have made a wise choice. And there's one story that Jesus Christ told. When we say story, that's like a parable, an illustration. But many, many people fit into this illustration. I'm talking about the choice of a fool. The choice of a fool. My point number two. I'm looking at Luke chapter 12. And there I read from verse 16. And he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? And because I have no room where to bestow my fruit. As you read this story, as you read the parable, you're going to find the use of I, me, my, this is my life. And this is my time, and this is my work, and this is my barn, and this is my fruit. Everything is all centered on self. He didn't think about the one that created the whole universe, that created the ground on which he planted. He didn't think about the one that created the seed that he sowed. He didn't think about the one that brought the rain and the sunshine. He didn't think about the one that brought the harvest. It's just my. What a foolish man he was. And then he said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. As if he knew how to keep himself alive until tomorrow, until next year. And then he said, and this will I do. Look at this man talking it like almost like God. This I will do. He didn't reckon that there was any Satan in the world. He didn't reckon that there are adverse circumstances in the world. He didn't reckon that God only controls life and controls everyone's destiny or progress. He just said, this is me, and this is what I am going to do. He made himself a little God. You know what the Lord is telling us? The Lord is saying, you know, you cannot dictate tomorrow. Neither do you know what is going to happen. He says, this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build the greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. I was in Nigeria. I move around quite a lot in Nigeria and also in Africa. I go to all these various countries. In a particular city in Nigeria, when I got there, we were having this evening meeting crusade. And I went to, we have the people who call kings. Those kings are like, you know, they're not chosen politically. They follow after the Bible pattern of this king has died, and then the son will take over. And then when that dies, another one will take over. And they rule, they control all the people under their jurisdiction. And so I went to pay courtesy call to the king because we're having crusade there. And I told the king, and the king was looking fine and looking quite healthy and strong. And when I got there, and I was thinking, what am I going to tell the king? Because in our place, that is in our country, when you go to visit a king like that, you are very careful. They tell you to remove your shoe as a sign of respect for the king. And then they tell you to, you know, you lie prostrate on the ground for them. But they granted me some kind of privilege that, you know, when I come in, they understand that I'm a preacher, they are kings, I'm, you know, a kind of spiritual and they are secular. So I went in and, you know, wore my shoe and, you know, shook his hand. After all, he was educated to them level. And then we sat down and he told me to talk. And then I spoke to him and then I invited him to the evening meeting. And when that night I didn't know what was going to take place. And the king was, the wife was there. And the royal family, all those people, they came. And I told them that night I was going to talk about the wise and the fool. And I told them a story that in the olden days, there was a particular king. And think about me talking about a king when a king was, you know, supposed to be there. And in our land, you don't do that. But by the grace of God, whatever God says I ought to say, I say. I think that's a wise track to follow. Don't you think? I said, don't you think? Yes, praise the Lord. And so I said there was a king. And this king had a clown that normally made him happy and, you know, made him joyous and would tell him stories and all that. And so this king, he was about to die. And he said, my clown, that's what they call them, go and search all over the land and find somebody who is a greater fool than yourself, because they call the clown a fool. And then he went everywhere and went everywhere, and then he came back. And then the king promised, I'm going to give this staff unto you, unto that person that is a greater fool than yourself. And when this clown went all over, he came back. And the king said, where is the one that's a greater fool than yourself? He said, I've not found. But king, can I ask you a question? I said, go ahead. You're going on a long journey. You are old. You are about to die. Now you tell me, have you prepared for this long journey? And the king said, no, not at all. And when he said, no, not at all, then the clown said, you are a greater fool than myself. If I were going on a long journey, I'll prepare. And so he said, take the staff for yourself, because you are a greater fool. And the king was there, that is, in this city that I went. He was hearing everything I was saying. And when I came down from the pulpit after the whole meeting, I went to the king. I said, when did you come? Did you come at the moment I was talking about the king? Then I repeated the whole scene unto him. And I said, king, don't be a fool, be wise. He says, thank you very much. What I want to say is that was Friday. On Wednesday, the following week, he died. What if, I don't know what he did, what the message. But the Lord is challenging you and challenging me, challenging everyone. Be wise. Think about eternity. And let the choice you make today be a choice that counts for eternity, that you say, praise the Lord, I know that Jesus Christ is a Savior. God the Father has given Jesus Christ unto us, not to come and develop religion, institute religion, propagate religion. He comes to take our sins away, an exchange of righteousness and sin. He takes our sin to himself, and then he gives us his righteousness. And when you accept that exchange, that transaction, you say, thank you, Lord, you died for me to take my sins away. And here you are all righteous. And then you are giving your righteousness to me. Lord, I accept. And then you make that wise decision in your life. You'll never be the same again in Jesus' name. And then your name enters the book of life in heaven. And God says, that's my child. He is righteous. And he looks at you in the righteousness of Christ. But let's come back to this, our man here. And then he says, in verse 19, I will say unto my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat and drink and be merry. And God said unto him, this is the point, and God said unto him, he had position, he had riches, he had wealth, he might have a family, and had profession, had everything, but he was not prepared for the real future. And God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? And the Lord Jesus made a conclusion. And he said, so is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. The Lord is calling us that here is the wise and here is the fool. And the Lord says, make your choice. Come either this side or this side. Salvation is very easy. Salvation is just like I'm making up my mind. The wise decision is this. I take Jesus as my Savior. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I cannot save myself. Could my tears forever flow? And my zeal no respite know? All these for sin cannot atone. Thou and thou alone must save. Rock of ages, clear for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from your wounded side that flowed be of sin the double cure. Cleanse me, forgive me. That's all. It's paid the price already. And salvation is free. How will anybody, if that person is wise, reject this free salvation that makes you to have heaven? And then just, I'm ashamed to be able to, you know, come out and say, I declare for Jesus, ashamed. When heaven is waiting for you, and when forgiveness and peace of mind is waiting for you, the wisest thing to do is to say, Lord, I am a candidate for salvation. You died for me. I'm going to have that salvation. I come to number three now. Our choice by faith. Our choice by faith. You know what God said? He said, without faith, it's impossible to please him. You might have self-righteousness. That doesn't please God. Because he sees through the kind of superficial life we live and we say, this is righteous. You know, anytime when anybody says he's righteous, you know, what we're doing is we're comparing ourselves with the man on the street, and we're saying, I'm better than that. Because I'm better than that one, therefore I am righteous. Don't compare yourself with the, you know, criminals and the evil people. Compare yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ, then you will know you are not righteous. When you put Jesus Christ there, and then you put yourself there, you say, Lord, there's no way I can match your righteousness. Then you know by yourself you're not righteous. And the line of faith, the path of faith, is to say, Lord, here am I know I'm a sinner, and I know that you died for me, and I know that at this very moment you have said, if I will confess and forsake and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I will be saved. And that's exactly what I do now. I take Jesus as my personal Savior. That's all. And then he says, whosoever will call on him and believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, you will be saved. Because with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. With the heart, you believe unto righteousness. And the moment you say, yes, Lord, I am the one. I am the one. I'm coming to the Lord now. And the Lord says, I receive you. All your sins you ever committed since you were born, everything is wiped away. New life comes unto you. And now you'll be on your way to heaven. That is the choice he wants us to make. It's the choice of the wise. And the choice of faith, that's the choice we're going to make. I said, that's the choice we're going to make. You know, somebody said, I would have made the choice, but I didn't like the way it was presented. You know, it's like somebody coming and he says, hey, you've been walking on your foot every time, and I want to give you a car so that to make life easy for you. You say, my friend, I would have gotten the car from you, but the way you said it, I didn't like it. Therefore, I reject the car. I say, why don't you overlook the way he said it and get the car all the same? Then you become a car owner rather than saying, I don't like that way. I'm coming from Africa and my culture is different from yours. And the way, the best way I know how to preserve, to tell you to be wise, that's what I've told you tonight. So don't worry about the way I said it or the way I didn't say it. Maybe they say it a different way here. All I'm saying is eternal life is waiting for you. All I'm saying is salvation is waiting for you. All I'm saying is, with just a moment of decision, heaven could be your final home and your eternal home. Forget about the way it was said and say, Lord, I accept that. I'm going to have eternal life. Come out of religion and come to the righteousness of Christ. And whosoever, and you are that whosoever. Am I right? You are that whosoever. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And that salvation is available now for the men, for the women, for the young, and for the old. Let's rise up as we talk to the Lord in prayer. Saying, oh Lord, I want to be the wise man. I want to be the wise woman. I want to make a choice. A choice that will grant me, secure for me, a home in eternity. The choice that counts for eternity. The choice that counts for eternity. Just bow your head and you just tell, choice that counts for eternity. The choice that counts for eternity. Just bow your head and you just tell them, or death, either eternal life or eternal death. And I'm making my choice right now. I accept Jesus as my personal Savior. Lord, I know. Nobody needs to tell me. My conscience tells me I am a sinner. My neighbors know I am a sinner. Those who are close enough to me, They know that I am a sinner. And I accept, I confess, I am a sinner. I have no righteousness to parade before you. All I have is the righteousness of Christ. I take Jesus Christ as my substitute. Jesus Christ as my Savior. Jesus Christ as the only one to bear the punishment of my sin. And I accept you. You'll be my Savior forever. That's all he wants you to do. That's the choice you make. But if you reject him, that will be the decision, the choice of the foolish. Be wise. Call upon the Lord. Accept his sacrifice. And once you accept, that's all, that's all, that's all. Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. It was for me you died. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. If you are taking that decision now, and you want to make it real and practical, and you want the Lord to know that you have taken that wise decision, no more trying to save yourself, no more trying that religion or self-righteousness will save you, and you're saying, Lord, here am I, here am I. Whatever you want me to do, I am here. I belong to you from now on. Take all my sins away and give me your righteousness. If you are taking that decision or you are making that choice, now just raise up your hand. I'm going to pray with you. Anywhere you are, you're saying, Lord, here am I. I give myself to you. Thank you very much. God bless you. Just tell the Lord right there under your breath and say, Lord, here am I. I give myself to you, and I make the choice of the wise right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for all these people that have raised up their hands and those who have not raised up their hands, but they are taking that decision. Lord, I pray that the decision, the choice of the wise they're taking today, I pray, Lord, you will stamp it with your stamp of authority. Accept them as they have come to Christ and to you through Christ in Jesus' name. Forgive their sins, Lord. Change their lives. Turn their lives around. And let this decision of the wise take effect in their lives. That, Lord, you'll bear witness by your Spirit in their hearts that they are now the children of God. Confirm in their heart the salvation you have given unto them, the eternal life you have given unto them. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Now, you have any challenge in your life, you're sick, you have any other problem, the Lord is able to take that away too. That's part of the deal. That's part of what he does for us when we come to the side of the Lord. And so if you want any healing or deliverance, whatever, you can raise up your hand and we'll pray together. The Lord will accomplish it in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you and bless your name. We know that you are the same. You have never changed. You still heal the sick. You deliver the oppressed. And you do good to your people. Therefore, Lord, I pray you break every yoke in every life in Jesus' name. And I pray that every sickness, every infirmity, you take away by your mighty power. Lord, confirm the miracle in everyone. And Lord, as we go, we pray that this decision to be wise will be a permanent decision. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. And the people of God said, amen. Thank you and God bless you.